Okay, so tell us a little bit about yourself, Jacqueline, your story, why you chose MSU, and just tell us about yourself.
So, hi everyone. My name is Jacqueline. I am a senior majoring in biochemistry and molecular biology with biotechnology. I come from a small town called Limuru in Kenya. So, I am an international student. And I came to MSU in 2016 mainly because of research. So I wanted to have that hands-on research experience and get to apply what I'm learning from my classes directly into solving real-life problems. So that was the main reason that I came to MSU, and MSU had a lot of resources available to participate in, undergraduate research. So that really stood out, and I wanted to go into med school, so having those resources would have definitely helped me, and that's why I came here, and I've not regretted it since coming here.
I'm laughing because we did this interview earlier and it just did not work out, but really I always enjoy learning about Jacqueline and your experiences and your story. I'm very grateful to have met you through the program, and only wish you the best after this. Tell me about your research interest. How did you get involved with undergraduate research? You knew you wanted to come here for that. Mm-hmm. But just tell us about your story.
So I knew I wanted to come, to go to med school. So I wanted to do research within the medical field that would, place me in a better position when it comes to applying to medical schools. However, I enrolled in one anatomy class, and it was not what I wanted. I couldn't see myself as a doctor and, using all these terms that they were teaching us. So I dropped the class immediately after that very first day of classes, and I started looking for alternatives. And, so I was thinking, since medical research is not, what I want to go do right now, is that, in terms of a doctor, how about doing research in a lab setting? So complete scientific research. So I started looking for opportunities, and this was in my sophomore year, spring semester of my freshman year. So I started looking for opportunities over the summer, and after talking to some students, upperclassmen, they were like, oh yeah, over the summer the labs are empty, everybody has gone home, so professors are looking for people to fill in the gap. So I decided to stay on campus over the summer, and that's how I got my first research opportunity as a lab technician in the entomology department. So I did, within the entomology department, we were looking at narrowing down the lethal dose range of some of the pesticides that are being used in the peach farms in Bath County. So, over the summer, we would go out to the farms and, look for peaches that have been infested with, the oriental fruit moth larvae, and then bring those back and try to grow the larvae in the lab and, use the pesticides and see which concentration of the pesticide would kill them efficiently. So we did that over the summer, and then after we got a good colony over the fall semester, that's when we did a lot of data analysis, a lot of bioassays. So a lot of lab intensive work. However, I really did not enjoy the kind of research that we were doing. It was quite interesting, and I was getting to apply what I was learning from my classes, but it didn't really click with me. So I started looking for other opportunities, more into biochemistry, because I, as a biochemistry major, you come in and you start doing biochemistry, unlike other, you know, some of the other programs where you have to do prerequisites and all those things. So I really wanted to apply the biochemistry that I was getting, knowledge that I was getting. So I started volunteering in Dr. Eric Grotwohl's lab, where I've been for the last 3 years. And the first semester was training, learning how to work in a lab. I did not know anything about working in a molecular biology lab. I was from, my research experience was in the field, and experience from taking lab classes. So this was quite new. So the first semester was just research training. And then the second semester, I started doing some of the lab work. So from the research that I was doing with my postdoc, I got to have, you know, some data to present at URAF. And then from that, I moved on to, over the summer, I took, I got an internship in Kenya. So this is my sophomore year summer. I got an internship in Kenya, and we were working on, we were studying the African trypanosomiasis, or African sleeping sickness disease. And that was fun. It was fun learning about, you know, how this disease progresses in our body using the mouse model. But I didn't really like working with mice. It was not fun work working with mice. And this was, you know, human infective strains of the African trypanosomiasis. So if the mouse bites you, you're on drugs for the rest of your life, because there's no cure for that. So there's a lot of risks involved that I didn't really like. So when I came back, I stuck to my plant biochemistry lab, and I've been working on plants ever since. I've had a few research experiences here and there, quite some different, some quite similar, but.
And what was in the internship program?
It was in a program. It was just this biotech company in Kenya that I reached out, and I was like, oh, I would really love to know what the kind of research that you do. And they were very accommodating. So
that's awesome. Were you able to visit family while you were there?
Yeah. So I was I was living with my boyfriend. It was like 10, 15 minutes away from the company. So that was very convenient. My family, I got to see them like every weekend, which is quite nice.
Wow, what a great sort of just like very diverse set of research experiences that sort of were able to take you home. You know, you started off with the summer experience. And we like to talk about how most of the opportunities, if students are looking for opportunities on campus, it might be easier to start in the summer, because like you mentioned, everyone is gone doing an internship or a summer REU somewhere, or an NSF experience, NIH somewhere out there, like people looking for these other opportunities, because whether it's research and traveling, or looking to work with someone else at another university, so they leave MSU, but yet all this other research is still happening over the summer. And majority of research at MSU happens over the summer because of the weather. And so that experience of starting in the summer and then working your way into a lab in the academic year, and into a lab that, you know, slowly and surely you were able to identify what your research interests are and just what's going to keep you grounded in that experience. So that's a lot of different experiences that you've been able to take advantage of. And that's great. So you mentioned URAF earlier. Mm-hmm. What is URAF, and how would you describe that experience and other presentation experiences that you've had?
So URAF is the University Undergraduate Research and Arts Forum. So this is a symposium where undergrads, so over 900 undergrads, present their research in form of a poster or an oral presentation. So it could be an independent project that they did, or it could be a project that leads up to their thesis. And it's a nice way of knowing the kind of research that is being done on campus, the kind of research that is being done within your department, and even outside of your college sometimes. Because I got to learn a lot from all the URAFs. So I've participated in URAF since 2017. I think that was my first one. And you get to see a lot of different research. Some research you didn't even know exists. So I presented a URAF 2018. And, you know, I was a sophomore at the time. And it was a really fun but scary experience, you know, as a sophomore, and you're presenting in front of faculty and grad students and upperclassmen. It can be intimidating, but it was fun. It was a nice way of learning some of the questions that are asked when you're in a conference or in a seminar setup, looking at, you know, what are some of the topics that are relevant. You know, most, like, one of the biggest questions that I was asked by almost everybody is, so what? Why are you doing this research? Mm-hmm. How is it important? And, you know, being able to look for an answer and trying to take this huge research that you've done and then bring it to a point where, like, the lay audience will understand the significance of it. That was one thing that one skill that I really got from participating in URAF. From other presentations I've presented at the Gulf Coast Undergraduate Research Symposium, which is held at Rice University in Houston, Texas. I know you're from there.
Yeah. Nice and warm.
Yeah, it was really nice.
It's beautiful, huh?
Yeah, a nice break from the winter. So it was like September, October. So it was right
there. Oh, it was perfect weather then.
Perfect weather. So yeah, I got to present it at GCAS, and it was a conference where almost 1,000 students were in attendance, all in different majors, different fields of research, different fields of study. And, you know, being in such a setup and, you know, learning from other institutions, now you're not even looking at different departments or different colleges within your school, it's different departments across different schools, learning how they do their research, comparing it to how you do it, and then sharing how you do your research as an MSU student, because I was the only MSU student represented there.
Wow.
So that was a really nice experience, getting to learn from others and sharing about my research. And I got an award from that. I got the Most Outstanding Presentation Award.
That's awesome.
Quite interesting. I was so scared when I was giving my oral presentation. I had invited my cousins, so I would just look at them and I'm like, okay, they're smiling. Okay, if they're smiling, then I'm good. next slide. So that was really fun. And I think that's the highlight of all my presentations so far. I've also presented at the Ohio State during my graduate school interview weekends. So it was a seminar style presentation where you present on either a particular research or a summary of all the research projects that you've done. So I presented on one research projects that I'm actually writing my thesis on right now. So that was also a fun one. It was it was quite different because now you were presenting in front of faculty and graduate admissions. Wow. So they were asking a lot of tough questions, but
yeah. So, I mean, talk to me about that, about the graduate school process. How was it for you navigating that? Yeah, I think it's amazing that you're able to share your research and that process and kind of the importance of, you know, why do you do that? Why do we have to share our research when we're looking at grad school programs?
Mm-hmm. So this was one of the like different setups of graduate school applications. Most of them, it was, you know, meeting with professors for interviews during the day and then meeting with grad students, and then the grad students would present their poster. But this was a bit different in that there was a seminar within the graduate school, within the interview process, and it was a nice way of, you know, putting yourself out there and seeing the kind of questions that you are expected to know or to get as a graduate student, and also, you know, looking at what you're expected to know and the kind of knowledge that you're supposed to have for mm-hmm. grad school. That taught me a lot on, okay, so these are the gaps that I have in my knowledge and these are my strengths. So that was one, you know, one benefit of those seminars. But in terms of the graduate application process, it was a lot of work. I started in the summer.
Wow, okay.
So while I was doing, you know, full-time, I was working full-time in my lab. When I have free time, I used to look at, you know, which schools am I going to apply to? Which programs am I going to apply to? How much money will I need? Because graduate school applications are expensive and, you know, you need to save up if you're going to take the GRE, or if you're planning on going to medical school, you know, MCATs are also expensive and applications themselves are expensive, especially for an international student, because we pay a little bit more than the domestic student. So that this is some of the things that I had to consider. And also, you know, looking at the application itself, you have to write essays that are unique for each and every school. So I applied to 10 schools, and getting an essay for each and every school that is unique for each and every school, that was a really tasking, that was very tasking. And the good thing is that I reached out to a graduate student in the Graduate Women in Science, the MSU Graduate Women in Science a mentorship program.
Oh, okay.
She's called Anna Maria, so I'll probably give her a shout out right now. Anna Maria really helped me out in, you know, reviewing my essays. We would do like every week we would do like 3 essays, and it was a lot of work. And, you know, she's doing her research and I was like, I'm taking classes. It was a lot of work, but eventually it pays off, because, you know, for example, from the 10 schools, I got 7 interviews and interview invitations, and I interviewed at 6 of those schools. So I would say it paid off, you know, all the hard work, but definitely it was a grueling process.
You mentioned connecting with the Graduate Women in Science mm-hmm. group. What does it mean for you to be a STEMinist, a female scientist?
I would say it's one of the most intimidating things to be a scientist in the first place, and then to be a scientist, a female scientist, that's even a lot, you know, a huge load that you're putting on yourself. But I also like to think of it as an inspiration to other girls out there who are even capable of doing much more than I am, you know. If I can inspire a student out there who is in their freshman year of high school, they will probably accomplish a lot more by the time they get to where I am today. So if I can be an inspiration to the next generation, I will have succeeded as a female scientist. And at the same time, if I, you know, making the, you know, there's this making a world a better place, I would love to live it better than I found it, you know, taking the skills that I have learned and, you know, taking them back home in Kenya or the sub-Saharan region where they needed a lot more, you know, when it comes to developing drugs, thinking of new ways of doing agriculture. So it's a lot of, there's a lot of layers in being a female scientist, but I think being an inspiration would be my biggest would be my biggest accomplishment as a female scientist, if that ever.
Well, you are definitely inspiring. I mean, there's no doubt in that. Mm-hmm. What are your next plans, your post-graduation plans?
So right now I am graduating next week because we don't have a ceremony, unfortunately. But immediately after graduation, I plan on taking a break and doing non-school stuff. So I don't know, pick up a language. I'm planning on learning Spanish, actually.
Ah.
So maybe do that, to learn how to like knit or something. It's something non-school, non-science related. Take a break, and then so that by August I am able to, you know, get back on going to school and I'm joining the chemical and biological sciences program at the Scripps Research Institute in Florida campus. So I'm excited for that, and it's another 5 years of doctoral training, which will
When do you move? Are you staying here until August, or are you going down earlier?
So I'm supposed to move by July. So okay. I'll probably move in July 1st or mid-July, and then stay there until 5 years. For another five.
Hot down there at that time.
Oh, I'm excited. I'm excited for the weather. I need a different experience. I've experienced the winter now.
Definitely, what a change. You did 4 years here with the Michigan winters and going down south to Florida for 5 years.
Yes.
Wow.
I'm excited for that. And also excited for graduate training. You know, with graduate training, you open up yourself to a whole new world out there. I'm hoping to go into industry and maybe start my own lab in Kenya or East Africa. I'm planning on going back home after my graduate studies, so you know, bring back the experiences that I have and take them back home and see what we can do with the resources that we have in Africa.
And it's like full circle, right? It's you going to school, getting an investment in your education, going into research and bringing it back to our communities in a way that can help progress our communities in healthy and sustainable ways.
Yeah.
And so I think that's what keeps us grounded, right? In our education, is knowing what can we do with the knowledge that we gain as a result of going to school. Being away from home these many years, what can we do with that, right? How can we give back?
Exactly.
I think it's beautiful that you have that goal in mind, something that keeps you grounded in your purpose. And I think graduate school, you're going to need that grounding and that reminder. I think that's beautiful that you have that. Mm-hmm. What advice do you have for students who are going on their fourth year of undergraduate study? Or, you know, what questions should they be asking themselves when they're preparing to take that next step?
So my biggest advice would be planning. You know, plan yourself. What do you want to do, and what are the steps that will get you there? So if you want to go to grad school, okay, start looking at programs. Do you want schools that require the GRE or do not require the GRE? Do you have funding for the graduate school applications, or do you need to look for waivers? Actually, on that note about waivers, if you do want waivers, there's a Big Ten Graduate Expo at Purdue University.
Oh, nice. And
schools that attend that expo give out waivers to all the students that attend the expo. So that's one.
That expo is like just graduate school in general, or is it specific to a program?
It's graduate school in general. So they do, sometimes they do bring medical school, because I know the one I attended last year, they had, I think Penn State Medical School was there. Mm-hmm. So they do have different programs, and they do release like the names of the schools that will be there. So if you see like, oh, some of the schools will be in attendance, try and sign up for it. So I applied to 10 schools, and four of them were in attendance. So I got waivers for those four schools. I didn't pay anything. So that's one way of saving. And also like talking to the graduate program coordinator. That's one way of getting waivers and just explaining your situation. Sometimes this applications are very expensive, and you know, if you can talk yourself into getting a waiver, then do it. So that's one other thing. You know, also looking at, okay, so graduate school application fees, the MCATs, if you want to go into medical school, MCATs, start studying for those, start studying for the, some graduate school applications or medical school applications do have an exam component on it. Mm. So you know, try to brush up on what you learned in freshman year or whichever, and try to get those skills right now. So planning is a huge, huge thing if you're going into, you know, fourth year, so that by the time you're graduating, you already have something that you want to do. If it's going into industry, going into academia, going into working, whatever it is, yeah, you need to plan ahead.
Wow, those are really useful tips. I think sometimes we don't know about these programs unless we get involved or build our network about like this, the Big Ten, what did you call it? Expo?
Graduate Expo, the Big Ten
Graduate Expo. Yeah, that's a great opportunity for students want to learn more about graduate school. But those waivers are really important, because what would you say a grad school application generally costs?
Well, as an international student, I would average it as $100.
Wow.
Per application. So some could be less, because some could be a little bit more, but it averages out to $100. And, you know, if you're like me and you're applying to 10 schools, that's $1,000. You need to put in a lot of work hours to get such an amount of money. So, yeah, it's very expensive. But it's manageable anyway.
Man, well, lots of preparation, lots of research goes into the preparation. And it sounds like it's a lot of steps that you should be taking into consideration. But I really like the idea of like the planning in advance and making sure you know what you want to do, mm-hmm. so that you can take those steps and be prepared. Mm-hmm. I like to ask students at the interviews to do like shout outs to individuals who have impacted your journey, who just helped to get to where you're at now. So are there any people you want to shout out, thank?
So one person that I'm thinking of right now is my postdoc. I've been working with her since almost 2 years now, though I've known her since the beginning of working in virtual labs. Sunny, she's called Sunny. Sunny has been such an inspiration, you know, as a woman in, you know, in doing her postdoc. I think she even graduated. She got her postdoc, actually. So she is always an inspiration. She's one of the smartest people that I know. And, you know, looking at her and I'm like, I want to be you, you know, I want to be where you are and even go farther than, you know, where you are right now. She is such an inspiration, and I would just say, you know, to the next student that she mentors, you know, she's amazing, and use her, you know, take advantage of her, because she's one remarkable person. Also my PI, Dr. Eric Grotwald, he's such an inspiration as well, one of the smartest people in his field, and, you know, directly or indirectly has been an inspiration to, you know, all the work that I've done. And, you know, right now he's helping me with my reviewing my my thesis. He's in my thesis committee. So, you know, here he is, you know, shout out to him. He has been an amazing mentor over the years.
Well, we are releasing the announcement today for Mentor of the Year for the three mentors that were nominated and selected for this year. So I hope to see a shout out for your mentor on there. Thank you, Jacqueline, for your time. And apologize to our followers. We had some technical difficulties, but
Yeah, I don't know
It
what
was
happened to mine.
uploaded, so you can learn more about Jacqueline and her adventures with undergraduate research. So thank you so much for your time, Jacqueline, and
Thank
good
you so
luck.
much for having me, Amanda. Bye.
Bye.